Hi everyone, today at the seminar we are hosting Wojtek Nadara. Wojtek, please start.
Hello everybody, so yeah, I'm Wojtek. Thanks for the introduction. I'm from University of Warsaw, and today I will talk about paper Approximating Pathway for Graphs of Small Truth, and that's a joint work with Karla Grenland, Gwen Joret, and Bartosz Walczak. Okay. So we'll talk about a few width parameters of graphs, and the first one will be true width that I hope you are familiar with. But for the quick reminder, if we have a graph, we want to construct a tree of bugs where if we look at a particular vertex and look at bugs where it appears in, this subgraph of bugs should be connected. And for every edge in our graph, there should be a bug such that both of its ends belong to that bug. Generally want to minimize the biggest bug, and the size of the biggest bug minus one will be called the true width of this graph. The second notion is path width, which is very similar, but we additionally restrict that this tree of bugs is actually a path. And the third one is tree depth, which will not be connected to our results, but is important in terms of motivation. It may be less known, so I will define it. So the value of tree depth is the lowest height of a forest, such that there is a bijection between vertices of our graph and vertices of our forest. And each original edge of our graph G is mapped to an edge between descendant and ancestor in our forest. So on that picture on the right, this forest is this green tree, so it is a gray tree. And we see that each black edge goes between some ancestor and some descendants. So a tree depth of this graph will be 3. And there are some well-known relations between these parameters. First one is that we know that tree depth is at most a path width, which is obvious between every path decomposition is a valid tree decomposition. We know that path width plus one is not bigger than tree depth, and that is because for every tree depth decomposition can be easily transferred to path width decomposition, because we can take as its bugs, as bugs of this path decomposition, root leaf vertices from left to right in our tree depth decomposition. And it will be a valid decomposition of width tree depth minus one. And the last relation is that tree depth is not bigger than tree width plus one times logarithm of n plus one. But I will not prove this one. But it's not that complicated as well to prove. So first we'll talk about some canonical obstacles for small widths of values of these parameters. So a well-known result is that graphs that have big true width also have a big minor models of grids, and the other way around as well. If we have a big minor model of a big grid in our graph, then we know that it has big true width. For path width, such canonical obstacles are large complete binary trees. And for tree depth, canonical obstacles are long paths. And in all these cases, there are some relation in both ways. For example, big tree depth implies long paths, and long paths imply big tree depth. However, one problem with these relations is that the dependencies between these numbers could be big. I mean, the gaps between them could be big. What do I mean by that? For example, if we take a complete graph on n vertices, then its path width is n minus 1. However, the biggest complete binary tree that we can find within a graph on n vertices is of height order of log n. And that implies that a path width of that graph is at least order of log n. So we see that the like this gap between the real value of path width, which is order of n, and like the value lower bound implied by some weakness, which is log n here, like this gap is pretty big. And we would like to find some variants of these relations where they are polynomial. Okay. Yeah. So focus on polynomial versions. So for Turev and grids, these relations are already polynomial. This is well known result by Chaidoki and Chusui. Yeah. However, for path width and tree depth, it is not the case. Yeah. In order to get polynomial relations for tree depth, we'll need more canonical obstacles. So Kawada, Bayashi, and Rossmann proved that if tree depth of a graph is of order at least k to the fifth power times logarithm squared of k, then we have one of these three canonical obstacles for small values of tree depth. One of them is that tree width is at least k. Second outcome is that G contains a complete binary tree of height k as a minor. Or third outcome is that G contains a path of order 2 to the k. And each of these outcomes imply that the tree depth is at least k. So we see that the relation here between like the tree depth implied by witnesses and the like, real value of tree depth is polynomial. And this result was later on improved by me, Chedwiński, and Marcin Plipczuk, where we proved that if tree depth is of order at least XYZ, then we have a tree width at least X, or complete binary tree of height at y as a minor, or path of order 2 to z. So natural question that can be asked and was actually asked by Kawada, Bayashi, and Rossmann in their tree depth paper is that can we do something similar for path width? And we prove that yes, the answer is yes. And in particular, the theorem that we prove is that if path width is at least t times h plus 2, then it implies that true width of our graph is at least t, or g contains a complete binary tree of height h plus 1 as a minor. Yeah, so path width is in between true width and tree depth, so we need one more obstacle than in case of true width, which is complete binary tree, but we do not need long paths, which are obstacles for big tree depth, because long paths have path width one. And one open problem that I can already give you is ask whether it's true that if tree depth of graph is of order at least p times l, then it implies that path width is at least p, or G contains a path of order 2 to the L. And such result would fit nicely within that set of results, and in particular, composing it with our result for path width will imply the result, our result about tree depth that I mentioned on the previous slide. However, it is in contrast to like these previous theorems, in a meaning that the most important things, most important issues for these theorems for path width and tree depth was getting any polynomial relations. However, here polynomial relation is already known. It follows pretty easily from some results in this previous paper. We know that if 3DEF is at least p squared times L, then one of these two outcomes holds. So this is the only question where we want to improve the polynomial. Okay, and so now let's switch our focus to approximation algorithms. So for 2WIF, there is a classical result by Feige et al. That in polynomial time, we can approximate 2WIF within ratio square root of logarithm of 2WIF. And in our 2DEF paper, we proved that we can approximate 3DEF in polynomial time within ratio of 2WIF times logarithm to 1.5 of 2WIF. So that's approximation ratio. So to get like the upper bound, we need to multiply by 3DEF as well. And here we would like to provide an approximation algorithm for PathWIF. So we prove that a given graph G and its 3 decomposition of WIF T, we can output polynomial time an integer H. Three things, an integer H. Second thing, PathWIF decomposition of, not too wide PathWIF decomposition of WIF at most T plus 1 times H plus 1. And there's some certificate that PathWIF is at least H. And I will explain what are these certificates in a minute. These certificates prove that this PathWIF decomposition is not too far away from its true value. And the above theorem, composed with the square root of logarithm of 2WIF approximation for 2WIF, implies an approximation algorithm for PathWIF with ratio 3WIF times square root of logarithm of 2WIF. Okay. Any questions so far?
I think I got it.
So could you repeat?
I think I got it, so no questions.
Okay. And the proof of the theorem will be pretty simple, so I hope to explain it fully. Algorithm will be more complex, so I will give just a rough sketch of it. Okay, so let's talk about certificates for big PathWIF. So we'll define a sequence of classes of graphs, T0, T1, and so on, where T0 is just a class of connected graphs, and following classes will be defined recursively. And a class TH plus 1 is a class of connected graphs such that it contains three pairwise sets of vertices, and they do not need to form a partition of whole vertex set, such that graphs induced of these three vertex sets belong to the previous class. And any two of them can be connected by a path avoiding the third one. And these paths do not need to be necessarily disjoint. So we see like an example on this picture here of such connections. And we would like to prove a few properties of these certificates, of these graphs belonging to these classes. And the first one will be that if a graph belongs to TH, then it has a minor of a big binary tree, complete binary tree of height h. And in order to prove this, we need to strengthen this statement a little bit, and namely that for each vertex u, there exists a minor model of complete binary tree of height h, where u belongs to branches of its root. Or in other words, it means that U is either like a root of this minor, or there is a path from U to that root. So let's take some vertex U, and let's assume that it doesn't belong to these vertex sets or these paths, and let's take some path from U to that interesting part of the graph. And actually, the case where there is a path to one of these vertex sets or when there is a path to one of these paths. These two cases are a little bit different, but we'll explain just one of them. Where we have a path from U to let's say V1, that doesn't meet like other interesting parts of this graph along the way. So we enter set V1, and now we look at these red paths between V1 and V2 and V1 and V3. We take, since V1 is connected, we know that we can find two paths from that vertex where we entered V1 to vertices where, to two vertices where we'll exit from it, like beginnings of these two paths. And we can assume that paths, these two paths from that vertex to these two vertices have common prefix, and they branch out at some vertex R, and that R will be our root of our bigger binary tree. So we have constructed this red part, and based on our induction hypothesis, we know that we can find these green binary trees that are like of heights one smaller. These binary trees and paths from these vertices U2 and U3, where we entered sets V2 and V3, two roots. This red part of graph plus these two green binary, smaller binary trees, they all together form a binary tree of height one bigger. That concludes this proof by picture.
Could you repeat what was the base of this induction? Like, what was T0, T1?
T0 was like any connected graph. Binary tree of a height zero is a single vertex. You want to prove that like in a graph that belongs to TH, we can find a binary tree of height H and a path from this any arbitrary vertex to the root of this binary tree.
Okay.
And using like these properties, how we define these classes, we can combine these trees and make them bigger and bigger. So let's go to the next property. We would like to prove that graphs from TH have big path width. So having complete binary trees and minors already ensures that their path width is big, namely that that path width is at least H over 2. However, we can achieve a better bound with a very similar proof, namely that a path width is at least H. However, that proof is pretty similar to a proof that binary trees have big path width. And because of time constraints, maybe I will skip it. Because that factor of 2 is not that crucial. So now we are kind of ready to proceed to proof of theorem of our excluded minor characterization. So if we reformulate slightly our main theorem, it will say that every graph with true width t minus 1 has either a small path width, namely at most th plus 1, or contains complete binary tree of height h plus 1 as a minor. Instead of proving this one, we'll prove that we replace that second outcome with that it belongs to th plus 1. We already know that graphs that belong to th plus 1 have complete binary trees of height h plus 1 as a minor. So theorem 2 implies theorem 1. Yeah, and we'll focus on theorem 2. Yeah, and the reason for this is that just this these classes TTH have like better combining properties, let's say. It's easier to deal with them than with binary trees. Okay. However, we'll prove one more auxiliary lemma, which we'll call a combining lemma. And in that lemma, we have a tree decomposition and some path in it, like path of bugs. So here it's like B1, B2, B3, B4. This is some path that we'll call Q. And what we consider is we consider removing all vertices that belong to these bugs. And we look at what remained. So namely vertices that lie either fully within T1 or fully within T2 and so on. And we assume that what remained has a path with at most P. And given that, we want to produce a path decomposition for like whole graph G that is not too wide, namely at most wider by at most T. So size of these bugs. Here we have another proof by picture. So we look at path decompositions of T1, T2, T3, T4, and we concatenate them like from left to right. These are these tall bugs. And for the part where there is a path with decomposition of T1, we add vertices from B1. Why B1? Because it's like the bug that T1 was attached to. Similarly, for T2 and T3, we add vertices from B2. For T4, we add vertices from B4. And B3 is like alone. It doesn't have a subtree hanging out of it. But we want like at least one copy of B3 as well. And now we basically look at like this bugs altogether. So we create bugs of a size at most P plus 1 plus T. Where just for each bug from path of the composition of the subtrees, we add some bug from this path. And we can, if you look at this picture for like from left to right, it forms a path of decomposition of whole graph with all of at most P plus T. Any questions to that part?
No, you okay. you can proceed.
Okay. So now we are ready to prove our theorem. And we'll prove it by induction on H. So H equals 0 is easy because if G contains a cycle or a vertex of degree 3, we can find we already know that it belongs to T1. Because if we have a vertex of degree 3, like these three vertex sets will be arbitrary of its three neighbors. And there will be paths like going through that one vertex, central vertex. And if G contains a cycle, then we can take arbitrary three vertices on it and appropriate arcs on this appropriate paths on this cycle will omit the third vertex as well. And otherwise, our graph is a path, and its path with is one. So base is proven. Okay, so let's go to induction step and assume it works for H minus one. And take some tree decomposition of with T minus one. And there are two cases. In first case, there exists a bug, a queue, such that if we remove it, then all components of what remained are small. Graphs that do not belong to TH, I will call them small. Graphs that belong to TH, I will call them big. So if after removing one bug, everything is small, then we can use our a special case of our combining lemma, where this path is just a single bug queue. Yeah, so path of what remained was at most t times h minus 1 plus 1, yeah, and we make it bigger by t by adding this single bug to basically everything. So we have path with that is at most t times h plus 1. And in second case, what was the complement of this case? And the complement is that for each bug y, there is a neighbor. It has a neighbor x such that gxy is big. And what is gxy? Gxy is a graph on the right of x. So basically all vertices that lie fully within that subtree. In particular, they do not belong to, we do not include vertices from bug of y. So each bug has like a big neighbor. And one additional property of our tree decomposition that we'll use at some point is that gxy is connected, because if it is not connected, that we can basically divide it into like finer parts. We'll use it this property at some point. Okay, and if so now we will define set D. It is a set of oriented edges yx such that gxy is big. In particular, it could be the case that one edge can be directed in both ways if both the graph on the right and graph on the left are both big. Okay. Yes.
So it's no longer this one y. Now it's yx is arbitrary, right?
So in the first case, we assume that there exists a vertex such that all trees, all its neighbors will be small. And in the complement of this case, we know that each y has a neighbor x such that gxy is big. Okay. And in terms of these oriented edges, it means that there is at least one outgoing edge from every vertex. Is that clear?
Yeah, but my question was, this D is for, like, this is a set for, like, the whole graph, right? Like,
Yes.
This it's fine. Not for this particular Y.
Yes, exactly. Yes, it's, okay. So since there is at least one outgoing edge from every vertex, then we know that there are at least as many the oriented edges as there are vertices in this tree. In particular, it means that there exists an edge such that it is directed in both ways. Yes. And the next property is that if edge yz is directed towards z, if we have a picture like this, then edge from x to y is directed from x to y as well. Because if subgraph on the right of z is big, then subgraph on the right of y is big as well. Yes. And that property implies that set of edges that are directed in both ways is connected. Or in other words, it's some subtree. And because of that, we can consider a set Z that is set of its leaves. And we'll distinguish two cases. In the first case, this subtree induced by edges that are directed in both ways is a path. And in that case, like all these hanging out subtrees from T1, T2, T3, T4 are small. And because of that, they do not belong to H, they are small. In that case, we'll just done by combining lemma. Because they have small path width, and we can create a not too big path width for not too wide path width decomposition for whole graph. And in second case, where this subtree is like more complicated. It has at least three leaves. Then we look at arbitrary of its three leaves. And we know that like subtrees below them are big. So these are this GZ1, X1, and so on. And from these three big subtrees, we want to construct a bigger witness. So now that property that I mentioned earlier comes into play, that if we cut our tree decomposition and look at vertices that are only on one side, then they induce a connected set. And because of that, we know that if we look at some pair of these three big subtrees, and we remove the third one, we know that in that graph we still can find a path between these two big subtrees, big subgraphs. So yeah, we know that we have these three paths that are needed in the definition of our witness. So we know that we can combine them into these three witnesses into like even a bigger witness that belongs to TH plus one. Okay, so that concludes this proof. Any questions to that part?
We're fine.
Okay. So now we'll go to approximation algorithm. Let's talk about algorithm specification. So we want a polynomial time algorithm that, given a connected graph and its tree decomposition of width at most t minus one, computes three things. First one is that number h, such that g belongs to th, and path width is not too big, th plus one at most. We want a th witness for g. A th witness is just like this recursive decomposition, like pointing out these three vertices, vertex sets, v1, v2, v3, and connections between them, and like recursively doing the same. Yeah, and a third thing is that path decomposition of with at most th plus one. Yeah, and a corollary, which I mentioned earlier, is that connected with approximation algorithm for true width, this gives us a polynomial time algorithm for path width of width at most t times square root of logarithm of t times p. Okay. And we'll do this using dynamic bottom-up programming over tree decomposition. Okay, so we'll need a few definitions. So for x, x that is a bug, let vx be the set of vertices contained only in bugs that are descendants of x, including x. So that's kind of like a gx and parent of x from previous proof. Let k be the maximum value of h of x for x different than root. H of x is that number h computed for like descendants. And there will be basically two possible outcomes. First one is that we'll be able to keep h at the same level. A problem here will be just finding a better, like a good path with decomposition, like making it not bigger than it was for our descendants. And in the second case, we will allow ourselves to make our path with decomposition bigger. However, we need to provide a reason why we should make it bigger. And that reason is just finding a better witness. So here we have some picture. We have that BR is that root of our entire tree decomposition, of our like partial tree that we like in the meantime of in some intermediate step of our algorithm. And Z will be the set of minimal nodes z such that h of z is k. So on the on this picture we have like this three of these four bugs. For these bugs, like the value of h is k, and if we have some like parts of this tree that like hanging out to the side, then we know that in these parts there are no vertices with h of z equal to k. And we'll define a set U, which is everything except sets VZ. So for these four big subtrees, we have these sets VZ, like sets of vertices that are contained only within these bugs. And if we remove them, we get set U. And we'll create H that is auxiliary graph on Z. Auxiliary graph on these like leaves. And ZIZJ will be an edge in this graph if there exists a U path connecting VZI and VZJ. What is that U path? That U path is basically a connection between two big subgraphs that omits all other big subgraphs. So these are the connections that we can hypothetically use for constructing bigger witnesses. And if we have a cycle or a vertex of degree at least three in this auxiliary graph, then we know that G belongs to TK plus one. And we can actually compute a bigger witness easily. This is similar proof to what we have done before, where we combined three big subgraphs into one even bigger witness. Since G is connected, we know that that auxiliary graph is connected as well. If there is no cycle or vertex of degree at least three in that auxiliary graph, then we know that it is a path. Here we have another picture. We have these four boxes which denote these big subgraphs. We have these bugs BZ1, BZ2, BZ4, BZ3, BZ4, and the sub below them we have these subtrees. And all other vertices in our graph can be partitioned based on what big subgraphs are they connected to, meaning that there is a path from them to which big subgraph there is a path within you, like omitting these big subgraphs. And if you have a vertex it is connected to at least three big subgraphs, then we know that it would create a triangle in our auxiliary graph. And we know that it's not possible since we assume that this auxiliary graph is path. So all other vertices that do not belong to these big subgraphs are either connected to two of them or just one of them. Actually, that they can be partitioned to sets like U1-2, U2-3, U3-4, these are the sets that they're of vertices that are connected to first and second, second and third, third and fourth, and the vertices that are connected to just one of them, for example, only to second one, that's like U2, only to third one is U3. For vertices that are connected to first and last one, I could theoretically call them U1 and U4, but for some reasons that I will not explain, I will name them U01 and U45 because like they behave more like this sets UI I plus one than this sets UI. Okay. And so our plan is to somehow use our combining lemma to compute a good, not wide path decomposition. So we want to have some sequence of bugs. Okay, so let's try to create it. Let's traverse our tree decomposition along this red path. I think it's clear how it looks like. And we'll take a look at bugs along this red path. However, one problem within that sequence of bugs is that one bug can appear multiple times in it. And yeah, it's not really a path, right? And one vertex can appear in a non-connected set of bugs in that sequence. So we'll need to make some improvement to it. We want to draw that red path on this picture above. And that red path will tell us what is the currently interesting set of vertices on some segment of that red path. So for example, let's look at the segment of this red path between BZ1 and BZ2. It is, on this picture, it is within set U12, namely the set of vertices connected to first big subgraph and second big subgraph. And that tells us that if we traverse that red path, then to our set of vertices, set of bugs, we want to intersect them with that set U12. And because of that, all vertices will appear in a set of consecutive bugs in that sequence of bugs. On the segment between root and BZ1, we are interested only in vertices of U01, then we take callback BZ1, then we take intersect these bugs between first and second subtree with U12 and so on. Yeah, and we create some sequence of bugs. Okay, and we can think. Okay, and we can remove that path. We can remove all vertices that appeared in that sequence, and look at what remained. If all remaining components after removing these vertices are small, then we'll be done by combining lemma. That's just it. And in a case where in what remains there is some big component, we want to prove that we are able to construct a bigger witness. So if that big component lies, let's say, within U2, then what we want to do is we want to find these green connections. One of that connections will be between that big connected component C and big subgraph V1. One of them will be between C and V3. And one of them will be between VZ1 and VZ3. In that way, we are able to construct a bigger witness. And it can be argued that these green connections can be found if we take appropriate care. And second case is that that big component lies within some UI i plus 1, let's say U12. And in that case, these green connections will be to these two neighboring big subgraphs and these two subgraphs, big subgraphs, omitting C. It can be argued that they will exist as well. And actually, it can be proven that these are the only cases. There are no For example, it is not possible that C lies within U01 or U45, or that it somehow spans over multiple sets. So that's basically the rough sketch of this algorithm. However, there are a few caveats that I should talk about. First thing is that if we look at this picture, from our graph we removed some vertices, and we wanted to know what are the path widths of what remained. However, the graphs that we will get are hypothetically graphs that we haven't computed information about them so far. We do this. We basically do our algorithm in a dynamic bottom-up, dynamic programming bottom-up fashion. However, these subgraphs could be somehow weird. They are not necessarily something that we computed information about already. So a priori, there's exponential number of these subgraph calls. And that is that is a big problem. It could be proven that it will actually run in polynomial time with some care that need to be taken. Another thing that we need to care about is that if you remember that last step of our proof of excluded minor characterization theorem, we assume there that our tree decomposition behaves well in a meaning that if we cut it at some edge, the part on the left and on the right, they are both connected. And this is something that we need to care about in this algorithm as well, because that's basically how we get these green connections. However, it's not easy to satisfy this property when recursing without changing our tree decomposition a lot. And we can't change our tree decomposition a lot because we'll like memoize our results. We need good memoization for estimating our time complexity. Third caveat is that actually, I omitted a detail that our algorithm needs to take additional parameter as its input, namely an upper bound request that tells us, if my upper bound request is B, then I know that our graph belongs to like TK, that where K is bigger than B, that I don't really care about path decomposition. I do not need to compute it. I just care about the witness. And that's some, let's say, detail that's not important for high level understanding. And something that I already mentioned about is that we use a lot of memoization, and it's highly non-trivial why this algorithm is actually polynomial, but it is, and the polynomial is actually quite good. Not sure what it is. I think something like n squared log n, something like this. I am aware that this part could have been not that clear. But that's basically like a rough sketch how more or less it looks like. Any questions to that part?
No, I think you can proceed.
Okay. So last thing that should be pretty quick is a tightness section, where we prove that basically a theorem is more or less tight. That's its statement. And actually, we should observe that only interesting cases are when h is bigger than logarithm of t, because if it is not, then our result follows from some other result. And given that, we can for these parameters, we can prove that our theorem is tight, namely that there for all integers t and h, there is a graph with true with t and path with at least t h plus 1 minus 1 that contains no big binary tree, where big means 3 times maximum of h plus 1 and logarithm of t. And what is that example? That example is a ternary tree, a blown up ternary tree. If we take a ternary tree of height h plus 1, where each vertex is blown up to click on t vertices, and each edge is blown up to an arbitrary matching, then true width of this graph will be t. Path width of this graph will be t times h plus 1 minus 1. Because it's height, which is h plus 1 times t. And size of this graph is smaller than 3 to h plus 1 times t. So by volume argument, we know that there is no subdivision of a big complete binary tree in it. Of height h plus 1 times logarithm of t, which proves basically what you wanted. And that should be it. Any questions to that part? Okay, I hope that should have been clear. I hope that was simpler than approximation algorithm. Okay, and that's basically everything that I wanted to say. So thank you for attention.
Thanks, Wojtek. So if I have a question, it's more of a question on a high level, or maybe like, are there any corollaries of those results, for example, for FPD algorithms?
I didn't hear the...
Or FPT algorithms.
FPT.
Because I assume this is one of the main motivations for this area of research.
Yes, so... I think that there are probably many algorithms that operate on path of decomposition. I mean, algorithms where we are given true width decomposition are, of course, more popular. There are not that many cases where problem is easier for path decomposition than for true width decompositions. But path decomposition is, I think it's still a pretty popular width parameter, and there are no good approximation algorithms for it. Maybe one more thing that I could mention is that there is like an easy log of n approximation algorithm for a path width, but it can be, let's say, not satisfying because it is a function of size of whole graph, not just path width. I think that in that meaning, problems that are parameterized by path width, we should have a good path decomposition if you want to solve problems that are parameterized by path width. Okay, any more questions?
I was going to ask the same question, so nothing from me, I think.
Okay. Mm-hmm. Okay, so in that case, I think I can stop sharing my presentation and end it here.
Okay, I'm stopping the recording.